Now, one of the most important properties of electromagnetic waves, which we have not yet described, is known as polarization. And you might have heard about polaroid glasses, or you might have heard of polarizations of specific materials and so on. But what does this term actually mean, and what does that give us in terms of electromagnetic waves, and how can we use it for communications? Well, first, defining what polarization is, remember that what we got from our analysis of electromagnetic waves, the free case, the free electromagnetic waves, was that the electric and magnetic fields are mutually orthogonal, so they're perpendicular to each other, and they're also perpendicular to the direction of motion. But we never said that they should stay in the same plane. In fact, this is not generally true. So they're always orthogonal, but we never said how they should be oriented with respect to the free space. And so the property of electromagnetic waves to have different orientations of the electric or magnetic respectively fields with respect to the reference system is actually what we know as polarization. So the simplest case of polarization is linear polarization. And in fact, what linear polarization is the property of the electric or equivalently the magnetic field to oscillate in a single plane. And so if you think of the wave traveling forward, as you can see in the animation, then the electric field will always oscillate in the same plane, and the magnetic field will always oscillate on the same plane, which is orthogonal to the first, but they never change the plane in which they're oscillating. So we have the equality again, we have the properties of the electromagnetic wave which we spoke about, the two are mutually orthogonal, they're orthogonal to the direction of motion, but they never change their planes. And so we define vertical and horizontal polarization with respect to some reference direction, in the sense that if the electric field is in the horizontal plane, then we call the light horizontally polarized. If it's in the vertical plane, we call it vertically polarized. Now, you may ask yourself, but what is that direction? Well, it's any reference frame. So in a sense, these definitions are not fundamental. So if I am emitting with horizontally polarized light, and if I simply tilt my emitter by 90 degrees, suddenly I'm emitting in vertically polarized light. But the key point is that we can define those with respect to some reference frame which we have. And the good thing about them is that if we have a vertical polarization and a horizontal polarization, since they're mutually orthogonal, the electric fields do not interact with each other, as well as the magnetic field. So a vertically polarized wave, electromagnetic wave, will not interact with a horizontally polarized wave. Now, a bit more complicated looking, but actually much more useful, are the circular polarizations. And in that case, we again remember that the electric and magnetic fields are orthogonal to each other and to the direction of propagation, but we exploit something which we never truly thought of initially, that they don't have to be in the same plane. So what can happen is that, as you can see on the animation, the planes in which they are can rotate. And so the electric field and the magnetic field, they're still mutually orthogonal, but the whole wave, if you like, is rotating in such a way that in one full revolution, the electric field will be in the same plane it was in the beginning, but in the meanwhile, it traverses what is known as a helix. And so the tip of the electric field and the tip of the magnetic field, they're traversing what is known as a helix, this sort of spiral which you see in the animation. And depending on the direction of rotation, so if it's rotating clockwise or anti-clockwise with respect to the direction of propagation, we define right-handed and left-handed circular polarization. And in fact, the names come exactly from the fact that if you take your right hand and if your thumb points in the direction of motion, then your fingers will give the direction of rotation. On the other hand, if we take your left hand, then if your thumb is pointing in the direction of motion, your fingers will give the direction of rotation of left-handed polarized light. And these two are again orthogonal. What does that mean? It means that they do not interfere with each other. So having strictly right-handed polarized light and strictly left-handed polarized light, they oscillate in such a way that the two waves are not interacting. So the sine functions are not going to add up to each other, they're not going to spoil each other, if you like, and there will be no interference. Now, most generally, polarization is elliptical. So a source which has any kind of random processes which generate light or which generate radio waves or electromagnetic waves in general, will give out elliptically polarized electromagnetic waves. What does that mean? Well, it's something similar to circular polarization, but with the difference that we do not have the same maximal amplitudes on x and y directions. So in a sense, again, we have a rotation of the wave vector, but this time the correspondence between the maximum amplitude in one direction and maximum amplitude in another direction is not one-to-one. And so the figure which is described is actually an ellipse. And you can see in the animation the difference between the three kinds of polarization. In fact, we usually only refer to linear and circularly polarized light as being polarized, since generally light is always elliptically polarized. In fact, linear and circular polarizations are just a special case of elliptical, since if you take an ellipse and if you make its two semi-major axes being the same length, you get a circle. And in the same way, if you completely destroy one of the semi-major axes, you get a line, which is exactly the linear polarization case. And in this animation, you can see that, again, linear polarized light, it stays in the same plane, so the oscillation of the electric and the magnetic fields, it never leaves that same plane. Whereas in the circular polarization, we have what is clockwise or an anti-clockwise rotation of the vector, and so it describes a circle in time. On the other hand, for the elliptical polarization, we have this a bit more counterintuitive rotation, but it is the general case, it is what happens with light which has no preferred direction of polarization, so you have just a random addition of different polarizations and what you get this ellipse trace. What makes polarization so important? You must have heard of it, especially if you're dealing with antennas. Well, polarization is important because it allows us to effectively double our bandwidth. What I mean by this, and what we're going to learn about bandwidth very soon, is that polarized light allows us to emit and receive at the same time without interference. So we saw in the previous sections that two waves at the same point in space, they do something known as interference. So the signals add up and they modify each other into something new. And so if you are transmitting information and you want to receive information at the same time, well, maybe the receiving and emitting waves will interact in such a way as to basically remove the information from each other. So you're going to lose information because of the interference of waves. This is not just about receiving and emitting, it's also about receiving in a given frequency and having someone else receive in a very similar frequency nearby. So waves can interfere, and polarization is one way to guarantee that you can have two separate waves in the same point without fearing their interference. Since if you transmit in vertical and receive in horizontal, the two vectors, the electric fields of the vertical and the horizontal polarizations, will never really interfere since they're orthogonal to each other at every point and they will never contribute to each other in a sense. Now, what is important to note is that circular polarization is in a sense much more comfortable since it allows us to have any orientation, any rotation if you like, of our satellite and still have circular light. As I said, rotation of the circular polarization is in some sense intrinsic since it doesn't matter if your satellite is tilted by a few degrees, you always have right-handed or left-handed circular polarization. While in the case of linear polarization, if your satellite gets tilted by 90 degrees, vertical becomes horizontal and vice versa. And so, especially for satellite communications, circular polarization is far more useful since it allows you to define the polarization and to use it without that much ambiguity as to what is what. And now, one last note to make before concluding with this section is that linear and circular polarizations are not independent. And so, while two linear polarizations, horizontal and vertical, are independent in between themselves and you can transmit and receive with them with no interference, and while the two circular polarizations are independent among themselves, circular and linear are not. This is true since you can get one from the other. In fact, you can look at a linear polarization as a combination of two circular polarized waves which are rotating in a specific way, which have a specific ratio, as you can see on the slide here. On the other hand, you can look at a circularly polarized wave as a superposition of two linearly polarized waves, which again, they are orthogonal to each other, and they have, in this way, they have the same wavelength and period. And so the two are not independent, but if we choose our type of polarization, so vertical and horizontal or circular, left and right-handed, essentially we have picked two linearly independent solutions to the equations, and we have two independent waves which can propagate and which can be at the same point at the same time without interfering and damaging the signal of each other.